Megan Faces Derision.
A Spirit Guide. A Ghost Tiger and One Scary Mother. The Megan Series.
Book 8.
Written by Owen Jones. Narrated by Robert Sebastian Cooper.
Copyright 29th November 2019. This is Volume 8.
In the 23-part Megan Series. For more information, please go to meganthemisconception.com. Dedication. This edition is dedicated to my wife, Pranon Jones, for making my life as easy as she can.
And she makes a great job of it.
Karma will repay everyone in just kind.
Contents. Acknowledgements. 1. Problems at school. 2. Megan becomes depressed. 3. Megan seeks a solution. 4. Evan's speedy brain syndrome. 5. Wackenhincher. Glossary. The disallowed. Acknowledgement. Thanks are due to the artist who did the cover for me, Jacqueline Chavaria.
1. Problems at school. Megan had always liked school in the way that people do who are good at it, but she'd also found it preferable to being at home alone with her mother in the early days. Her mother's attitude towards her had improved immensely over the previous 12 months, but she still enjoyed going to school, just not quite as much as before. Fainton, the town in which she lived, was of medium size, about 50,000 inhabitants, and had 5 junior schools scattered around it. So when she was in junior school, until the age of 11, she had known everyone in her class for 5 years. They were the closest people she had to brothers and sisters. However, at the age of 11, all the pupils from the 5 junior schools sent all their 11-year-olds to the one huge secondary school. There they were streamed. So Megan ended up in a class with children that she'd never met before. She'd been put into class 1-3, which meant that she was in the 3rd brightest class in the first year. Only one other of her former classmates had gone in there with her, but the other 28 were total strangers, although she could still meet her old friends at break and lunchtimes. The placing into classes had been based on the simple tests that each student had sat in junior school, but the restreaming at the end of each year in secondary school was more scientific, and Megan had been moved to Form 2-2. Again, there was only one of her old friends there, and now, at the age of 13, she was in 3-1. And there was no one from her old junior school. She liked being in the top class, but she found it a little lonely since most of her new classmates seemed to have come from 2 of the junior schools, so they could be a bit cliquey. This had the effect of isolating Megan, and her response was to focus on her schoolwork. It didn't bother her too much because she'd always been a bit different, and although she'd never felt shunned, she and everyone knew that she was not quite like everyone else. Megan's explanations for events that happened in everyday life were derived from her spirit guide, Wackenhincher, who had been a member of the Sioux Nation the last time he had been on Earth, whereas other people's rationalizations came mostly from their parents or the television. Most people's grandfather took them to the seaside by car, whereas hers had taught her to fly while her body was resting. Most people would have kept quiet about these things if they were happening to them, but Megan did not. Her friends from her old junior school had grown up with Megan and so knew what she was like, but her new classmates did not, and even at 13 were already a little too steeped in society's traditional way of explaining things. Some openly laughed at her, but most just thought she was odd. Still, having had her own mother criticize her for her beliefs all her life, she could put up with that because she could tell that they were reacting from positions of ignorance or fear. She could understand that fear was her mother's problem too, but most of the children she knew just did not know. They were ignorant of psychic matters because churches did not teach them or even believe in them, and the kids believed what they were told. She felt sorry for them because they had a steeper uphill battle to come than she was facing at that time. Megan had the benefit of knowing that she was right, whereas the others only thought they were. However, it did mean that some kids in her class would jump on any mistake that she made, seize every opportunity to laugh at her or call her stupid. There were only two or three ringleaders, really, but once they started, their friends usually joined in. It was a form of bullying, but it was nothing that she couldn't handle. She had witnessed other children being bullied far worse because they were weaker-willed than she and scared to go to an authority figure. Megan had never felt the need to do either. In fact, she'd never even told her parents, although she was considering doing so if things didn't sort themselves out soon. In her last two classes, the situation had improved as the school year drew on, as they all got to know each other, and as the bullies tired of picking on someone who seemed impervious to their mockery. Megan did not bear a grudge, so if anyone wanted to befriend her, she welcomed them, whether they'd been one of the antagonists or not. They were to be pitied, she reminded herself, because they didn't have a Sioux friend, a Siberian tiger, or a flying grandfather. She didn't mind what others believed and never criticized others' religions or argued with them about them, because she didn't know anyone who'd had the same experiences as she'd had, although that never made her doubt her own sanity either. She felt very fortunate to be able to do what she did, although Wagon Hincher had told her that this was not luck, because she must have been working at it for many lifetimes to become so proficient. However, even compliments like these did not have the effect of making her big-headed. She knew that her spirit's friends were always right, but she chose not to see it like that, because it meant that there was less chance of her becoming egoistic. However, it was not only Megan's religious beliefs that caused some kids to make fun of her. There were also the fact that she was good in school. She was in the top class, so she was called SWAT and teacher's pet by some of the children in lower grades. But she was not alone in this. Kids in the top three classes faced the same taunting, really, although most of the others had friends to bear it out with, whereas Megan did not. Then there was Megan's friendship with Mrs. Williams, the mayoress of the town, and Megan's Saturday morning job with the SOS Green Party in Mrs. Williams' office. This set her apart as much as her spiritualistic beliefs and psychic powers, because there were so many other spiritualists in Fainton. But there were no other 13-year-olds with special dispensation from the council to work for a political party, which was also in office. Furthermore, the mayor often sent her chauffeur-driven stretch Mercedes to pick her up from school and take her home. She had considered asking Mrs. Williams not to do it anymore, but then she had thought, why should she pander to people's jealousy? It was better to show people that their base emotions would not win them any prizes than to give in to them and let them think that a scowl and a taunt would get them what they wanted. If there were times when things like this mild form of bullying and jealousy did get on top of her, she never found herself alone, no matter where she was. Grrr was often with her at school, and when she went walking. She also spent a lot of time asleep on her bed when Megan was doing her homework or researching her next article for the SOS Green Party. Wacken Hincher usually appeared to her when she was in her bed or just in her bedroom, but before she went to sleep and her beloved grandfather came to her when she was asleep, although he was no dream. She loved all three of them, but she had no favourite. Grrr and Gramps was such a comfort, although she could speak to her grandfather and Wacken Hincher, who, like a friendly person, was more like a teacher, albeit a very caring one, rather like Mrs. Henshaw, a form teacher at school, who also cared about the children and doing her job well. Megan had experienced some rude comments on the internet about her articles, especially where they concerned the party, but she forgave the senders because they probably didn't realise that they were insulting a 13-year-old girl, since she only signed them with her name, not her age. She had also been called a witch and a liar because of her article about finding the mayoress's cat, although that hadn't bothered her either. However, there was one thing that did really upset her, and that was her ability to read aloud. Despite being in the top class of her school, she did have some problems with reading. Not reading in general, but reading aloud in specific. When she read in her head, she sometimes made a mistake, and sometimes those mistakes were quite funny, making her laugh. But when she was reading aloud before class...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.